I'm Sean O'Donoghue. I'm one of the community coordinators for UK Smart Recovery in Scotland. We're quite a small team UK-wide, but we're actually an international global company. In the UK, I think right before COVID, we had roughly, I think at our last quarter check, it was like 500 meetings UK-wide. 200 of those were in Scotland. Me and Ian are really trying to push and develop as many smart meetings in Scotland as possible. I'm not going to lie, right before lockdown, my role has completely changed. UK Smart Recovery is an organisation, and what we offer is free mutual aid meetings. Our meetings are normally funded after going through a partnership by local alcohol and drug partnerships, where we get a chance to deliver a programme and train volunteers. And the volunteers are normally people with lived experience. And I'm one of those people with lived experience. So if I just spend a minute or two talking just slightly about myself before I kind of dive into some of the trends in that I spotted with alcohol and mental health. I'm a veteran. I was in the Air Force for 8 years. I'm also a person with a dual diagnosis. I had chaotic alcohol behaviour, but this is partly due to my other mental health condition. So obviously being in the Air Force and having like childhood traumas and witnessing various traumas. I mean, I grew up in a rough area in Scotland, so I mean, seeing trauma was a normal everyday thing in life. I never realised what it was like to be normal until later on in life. But in the Air Force, like, I'd done 2 tours in Iraq, and that had a massive, massive impact on me as a person and basically my mental health. And cut a long story short, I ended up like almost drinking myself to death, and that's putting it bluntly. But luckily, veterans get priority in the NHS, and in the NHS kind of dive on top of me, and I had motivation to get better in that as well, which was kind of key. I never realised how much key that was until later on in my recovery. But the NHS kind of wrapped me up, combat stress and various other charities and that as well supported me, and all of a sudden I never felt as alone, and I suddenly started to realise it wasn't just me going through it, there was a lot of veterans going through the kind of same thing. And to put it politely, it took me roughly about 2 years recovery. But during that 2 years, as a veteran, being a veteran, we're kind of highly motivated, so we get bored quite quickly. That's another trend we've spotted. So when we get bored quite quickly, I start to realise, it's like, wait a minute, like, I mean, I should be helping out because someone helped me, so I need to give back. So there's still that team play, institutionalised behaviour in me. So I started becoming a volunteer, and I'm actually an engineer to trade, and all of a sudden I started to love working with people. I loved it better than any engineering I've ever done. So I ended up like volunteer for SMART for roughly a couple of years before I ended up applying for this post. And I also started studying as well because the curiosity was getting the better of me. Initially, when I first started recovery, I got told it was a disease, and that never sat well with me. And I was like, well, straight away, because I was quite inquisitive, I was like, wait a minute, I've got trauma. Trauma wasn't my fault. Growing up wasn't my fault. I was almost a victim of my own environment. I mean, even I knew that. That was my insight in my own addiction. And I was like, wait a minute. So the disease part never really sat with me. Although, because like some of my family members did have it as well, there was a little part of the disease part I did believe as well. I went, there must be some sort of genetic thing. But the genetic thing could have been my socioeconomic like background in that as well. It could have been I was just unfortunately part of that. So the curiosity went better to me, and I signed up for an Open University course. So I'm sitting working through my second year of psychology degree, and that's just opened up my mind like totally. I'm just like constant studying, constant moving, and I'm getting a chance to kind of apply it with the work I do as well. So that's just a wee bit about, me. Just to let you know, like, I'm a personal lived experience, and I'm also kind of now classed as a professional in smart recovery. But I'm doing all right now, and I'm actually about two stone heavier than I was when I was not well. So everything about me, I mean, it took a long time to recover, but I'm here and I'm grateful. And I'm just trying to give back and don't want anyone suffering what I suffer from. And that'll give you an idea about some of my core values. Right, so I'll go back to the kind of smart recovery stuff now that I've kind of bored you about myself. So the smart recovery stuff, right, what I've noticed, right, pre-lockdown, it was quite functional the way we had an online team. So the online team would be for people who were slightly anxious or maybe not too confident to come face-to-face. So we tried to get that kind of demographic. I love going out to the communities, working face to face. So I cover from Edinburgh through to Glasgow, and I was also going up to Inverness, and then also I was talking for other agencies down in England and that as well. And I was travelling up and down to Manchester. That's all stopped. And then what I noticed as well, I just started up a veteran group, and I've also been working with also more people in the community with multiple issues between alcohol, drugs, some of them just gambling, some of them even self-harm. They like to use groups, overeaters, because we don't, at Smart Recovery, we don't really look at the substance, we look at the behaviour, how we can help you change your behaviour. The whole Smart Recovery ethos is self-management and recovery training. So the way I kind of do it, without going too much into psychology, is I'll say to, like, people, like, in my meetings initially, like, just go, like, the hassles, like, in between here, but you've also got the keys in between here to help fix it, and you'll kind of do that wraparound support. I always look at somebody's, like, basic needs in that as well. I mean, because someone walking at my meeting, I can't advertise recovery if they're coming starving, so the first thing I really want to look at is a food bank. So I have to, like, take a lot of aspects into consideration, and I'm having to do that now more online than I was doing it face-to-face. And face-to-face, like, other agencies would pick up, but if they come to me, then the onus lands on, like, me as a facilitator or stuff like that. But, like I say, I like to go into some of the kind of trends I spotted. So the trends were kind of the more civilian community members looking for help with alcohol. Their alcohol and relapse rate, without going into figures, has kind of shot up. Now, when I say shot up, I mean this is, like, from all the people I work with. So I can work in 1 week anything between 5 people, like, up to 50 people, and it just depends how busy my week gets. But this is, like I say, like, once lockdown hit. A lot of people, like, because of the isolation and the lack of connection and boredom and various other factors, or getting furloughed and they can't cope with stress and anxiety, they started increasing their alcohol rate, and I was taking a lot more calls, and we were trying to get them back into, referred into services. But trying to do that as well when the services were under the same conditions we were was, like, very difficult. Some of the services in that shut down as well. They went right to the skeleton staff. They're waiting to shut up, and I'm like, oh my God, I can't actually physically get this person help. And that was quite terrifying as a worker. I was generally scared for some people. I mean, in my hometown just now, I think, but also I'm only just looking at Bowness, which is my hometown. I'm not looking at, like, Scotland as a whole. But interestingly, when I was working with the military members, we're not as faced. It's like when lockdown happened, our behaviour kind of stayed the same. If anything, I didn't realise I was doing it. It wasn't until I started to speak to the other military members that we're all on the same thing. We're like, right, this is a crisis. This is triage. We need food. We need water. We need to look after ourselves. And if you're drunk, we can't look after the family. And that's pretty much the kind of theme on us. So anybody who was using alcohol either reduced it slightly, except for some of the minority extreme cases, or they just kind of went, right, I kind of need to maintain it. And then they just can engage with more of the services and that as well. Because a lot of the services are very quickly adapted to, like, say, like, one-on-one, like Skype, Zoom, or one-on-one phone calls and stuff like that. So between my two kind of factions where I work, like, I've noticed, like, a big difference. Don't get me wrong, like, everybody who I kind of work with, some of the military members, like, some of them did get worse, but the majority never. A lot of civilians I work with, some of them actually got better and surprised me. One person who I thought was never ever going to make it, because the behaviour and evidence looking at them says they were going to be that bad, actually signed up for college. That was a shocker as well. And I actually love getting surprised. I mean, it's like the best part of my job. Someone waking up going, you know what, Sean, I'm like, I'm going to do it. Like, thanks for your help and thanks for pointing us in the right direction, but I'm going to do it this way. I mean, that's quite satisfying for me, like, people, like, finding their own way. Because it just goes to kind of goes to show what I kind of thought, like, years ago, like, if you're not kind of trying to find your own way or trying everything, like, and trying all the tools available and all the services, and I'm talking 12 steps, Smart Recovery, engaging one-on-one, maybe try to work out your mental health if your mental health is workable, again, engage with an appropriate service, like going to college, volunteering, giving something back, looking at your well-being. I think addiction for me is, it's a whole complex subject. I've yet to find the answer of how to fix somebody and apply it to 5 different people. Because I know my journey was different from the other person's, and any person working with, I know it might not work with them, because they'll tell me physically, oh, this isn't working, I need to try something else. And then I think the onus becomes back on me, and I'm like, right, if that's not working, where can I signpost them? Because I've got to realise as well, I'm now a professional, but I'm a professional with limitations, and I might not have the answer. So I try to like signpost as many people on that possible, but I also try to like kind of protect people as much as possible. Obviously, I'm kind of safeguarding that as well. During lockdown, I've had to run at the house once because somebody pretty much collapsed and the mum didn't know what to do. So I did kind of put myself in danger once, and that never ever happened. And the whole time I volunteered, and as a professional, as a year, I never once had to run out of the house, because I'm one of those third sector charities where I don't work as an NHS member or a paramedic or that, but I never had time because I'm already first aid trained. I never had time to go, right, I'm going to phone 999. I knew if I got there quick, I could keep them going. So that's exactly what I did. And well, so then I got a shock of COVID myself, because the paramedic, although I ran out the gloves and covered myself up, the paramedic went, well, you actually need to go home now, and you need to strip down, and you need to like, put your clothes straight in the washing machine, you need to scrub your house. And I was like, wow, this is like, I was unexpected. It's been a real shock how I've been working. And I think it's been a shock for everybody. And I think the shock is going to be researched for years to come. And the actual impact of alcohol and drinking deaths, I mean, I think I looked at the statistics for 2018. So we're sitting at 1136 in Scotland of people dying through alcohol-specific deaths. And I think that's roughly equates to, I think, was it 22 people every week. And again, the highest members affected is the 55 to 64 group. And I do see that in the groups I go. But if I'm in community rehab working across Scotland, I basically see the groups can be varied. They go from 21-year-old people, sometimes as young as 18, but they feel sometimes marginalised because most of the group is like older members. So sometimes when we're creating and developing community coordinates, smart groups, we'll have to do like specific groups. I'll have to go veteran groups. I'll have to go young people groups, like 18 to 24. I will have to go open groups. And I try to adapt some of the groups to the environment I'm working with. I don't expect groups to adapt to the way I work. I try to kind of community develop that way when I'm working across Scotland. But see, right now, I'm doing everything online. We were using a big blue button platform. I had to jump onto Zoom, because Zoom's quite more common. It's less IT issues, even though I just make a big loud noise on my phone earlier on. Other than me causing chaos, like Zoom generally works quite well. I take a lot more one-on-one phone calls than that as well, which is, it's good. I'd rather spend an hour talking someone out of drinking than spending an hour like trying to find out where they are. So I kind of work that way. I kind of work in almost reverse now. But other than that, we're still just trying to get through. We've still got kind of same problems, but it's like different, unique problems. And I'm pretty sure some of you are going to ask me interesting questions in that as well. I think, is that enough for you, Phil? Would you like me?
This is marvellous stuff. And with many comments on there saying it's a very inspiring story, and I have to agree with that. It's very good to hear, you know, your personal story and also stories from people you're working with. And not all is bleak, as the other two speakers have said. And you know, there are instances where people are sort of succeeding, maybe where we might think that this would be a reason for failure. And one of those is your military. You have two groups, don't you? You're kind of a civilian group and a military group. And you're saying the people who are ex-military are kind of more, in a way, responding to this quite well. Maybe it's a sort of familiar life and death scenario, I don't know. But is there something that we can sort of learn, you know, is there something about their approach which has sort of enabled them to cope with this situation well?
Yeah, well, I've used my own military experience, and pretty much every other military person I spoke to in the last couple of months. What the military do very good is train you like highly, and they make you feel comfortable as possible. So like, see me sitting in lockdown, I'm turning around now, I've got Wi-Fi because I'm on Zoom, I've got Netflix, I mean, I think I'm on Netflix part two now, to be fair, like, because of lockdown. But I mean, I've got Netflix, I've got Amazon Prime, I've got luxuries I never had on my tours. I mean, if I could get an hour off when I was out in the desert, and bear in mind, I was actually in real danger out there, and then getting a bit of food in a can of Fanta, that was luxury. So like, this is all kind of, it's strange, it's like still luxury to us. It's like we look at our basic needs, and our basic needs are getting met. The only thing that we're not getting met is like the connection, and that is still disturbing to us, but it's not as impactful as it would be to a civilian who's never experienced being stuck in a hole for 3 weeks, or you know, getting constantly attacked. We're basically fighting an invisible virus, and we're all kind of trained in like nuclear, biological, chemical warfare. Now, I know like how important it is scrubbing my hands, and even I make mistakes, and that gets highlighted in the training. it's just it's one of those things. I think it's because we are. It's more to do with the training. It definitely is more to do with training. If someone tells us to stay 2 meters away, chance you are going to do it because we're used to that authoritarian regime. I would love the whole UK. I mean, I think all the veterans share the same experience. Just shut it down, shut the borders. The virus can't transmit if no one is transmitting. it sounds like an obvious ask, but we know life doesn't work that way. People lose jobs and people's mental health is impacted. It's never that simple. But to a veteran, like I said, the simple answer would be just shut it down for 3 weeks and be uncomfortable for 3 weeks.
So following uncomfortable orders is probably, sort of paying off right now. And, you know, the other group, your other kind of civilian group, I mean, you're saying that some of them are experiencing some difficulties. Could you sort of go into what kind of things are troubling them and what kind of effect it might have had on their alcohol consumption?
Yeah, if I used a case example just recently, so basically this person was doing well for 9 months, ticking all the right boxes. I gauged for because I knew the connection and isolation was a big trigger for him before. Because I always encourage people to look at the triggers, because you look at the trigger first and the way smart works. If you look at your trigger before you get your craving, urgent behaviour, if you look at that trigger first, you have a bit more of a preventive measure rather than a reactive measure at the end to try to focus on the end part of the behaviour. And because I knew some of the triggers, I knew them personally, I just asked them to engage. I think it just got a bit too much for them. And it's really hard to ask for help. I mean, I was one of those people. I think it came up most in reports, like, I struggled to ask for help. And I think it's more a kind of UK society thing. It's like we're British, we don't like asking for help. We will muddle through. And it's I don't know if it's like kind of that. That's obviously me generalising, like, but I mean, we can be like quite robust and asking for help is, I don't know. This is why Andy's Man Clubs and that set up in the UK as well, because men are notorious like asking for help. Mm-hmm. I don't know why that is. I mean, I would love to research that myself when I get qualified. I mean, why do we find it so difficult to say, look, I'm actually struggling? But I've used this in smart meetings as well. Like, I've never once, when I was drinking, I went in a pub and says, oh, by the way, lads, I'm feeling rather emotional. Do you mind to watch that football game today where we talk about something that's really bothering me? No, it doesn't work that way in the pub. So I can maybe understand why, like some of the lads, like, I dislike asking for help. But that's something we need to look at the future. Like, but I mean, like, say, connection and isolation, of course, have been factors.
Yeah. You're saying that particularly in your, I think you're saying in your, particularly your military group, that they're more keen on sort of one-to-one interaction rather than the group interaction that there were.
Yeah, right. I don't know what it is, man. Sometimes I feel like I'm playing Where's Wally? I'll try to find some of the guys. It's like sometimes the guy will like, oh, where's that smart mate? That's all right, I've already checked out. I didn't want to go in. I'm like, wow. So they walked past my room and they've never came in. That was before lockdown. So, but what they would love to do is they'd love to chat one-on-one and keep it private, because a lot of the military guys are high-functioning, they've got jobs and that, and they're either maintaining addictive behaviour or they're at the kind of more extreme end, and then they're getting that wraparound care and they're getting everything chucked at them. And then very quickly, some of them bounce back like very, very quickly. I've not looked at too many veterans. I've only really been looking at them at Edinburgh and some of the guys I spoke to in Glasgow. So I'd like to get, obviously, up and down Scotland, really. But also my other colleague, like, he does that. We've only just started the veteran group, so we're interested to see what it's like in other areas. Yeah, but they definitely prefer one-on-one.